Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Barnum's Own Story, The Autobiography of P.T. Barnum, by P.T. Barnum, narrated by David Colacci. Editor's Note. Barnum's autobiography first appeared in 1855 as The Life of P.T. Barnum, written by himself. In his preface, the author wrote, "In these pages I have given the true history of my many adventures and the numerous enterprises in which I have been engaged. It will be seen that I have not covered up my so-called humbugs, but have given a full account even of such schemes as Joyce Heth, the Fiji Mermaid, and the Woolly Horse. Though a portion of my confessions may by some be considered injudicious, I prefer frankly to acknowledge the corn wherever I have had a hand in plucking it." But as he grew older and more prominent, this feeling about acknowledging the corn underwent a decided change. The plates used in his Life of 1855 were purchased and destroyed, and in 1869 he published a new and independent autobiography under the title Struggles and Triumphs, or 40 Years' Recollections of P.T. Barnum, written by himself. An atmosphere of pompous self-satisfaction, altogether lacking in the Life of 1855, makes itself felt in this later work. The story of his early career is much condensed, and the franker details either omitted altogether or so toned down as to appear innocent and respectable. This denaturing process was continued in several later editions, partially revised and with additional chapters or appendices, which appeared at intervals up to 1888, 3 years before the author's death. The present volume is a composite reprint of the 1855 Life and the various editions of Struggles and Triumphs, published from 1869 to 1888. The chief aim has been to present Barnum's own story as he himself first set it down, without regard to the qualms and tremors of respectability which gradually overcame the franker side of his nature. At the same time, the book has been subjected to a vigorous process of condensation by the omission of many irrelevant or trivial anecdotes, public speeches, letters, laudatory press comments, and other extraneous matter which clutters up the original. In 1888, Barnum stated that the various editions of his autobiography had sold to the extent of about 500,000 copies. The work has long been out of print in any form. It is hoped that the present reprint, restoring as it does the salt and savor of the original narrative, and also divesting it of a heavy load of superfluous material, will be welcomed by many thousands of readers among a newer generation, to whom the name of the great showman is still a household word, and his career one of the most picturesque and romantic in American life. Chapter 1. Early Boyhood. I was born in the town of Bethel, in the state of Connecticut, July 5, 1810. My name, Phineas Taylor, is derived from my maternal grandfather, who was a great wag in his way, and who, as I was his first grandchild, gravely handed over to my mother, at my christening, a gift deed in my behalf of 5 acres of land situated in that part of the parish of Bethel known as the Plum Trees. I was thus a real estate owner almost at my very birth, and of my property, Ivy Island, something shall be said anon. I think I can remember when I was not more than 2 years old, and the first person I recollect having seen was my grandfather. As I was his pet, and spent probably the larger half of my waking hours in his arms during the first 6 years of my life, my good mother estimates that the amount of lump sugar which I swallowed from his hands during that period could not have been less than 2 barrels. My grandfather would go farther, wait longer, work harder, and contrive deeper to carry out a practical joke than for anything else under heaven. In this one particular, as well as in many others, I am almost sorry to say I am his counterpart, for although nothing that I can conceive of delights me so much as playing off one of those dangerous things, and although I have enjoyed more hearty laughs in planning and executing them than from any one source in the world, and have generally tried to avoid giving offense, yet I have many times done so, and as often have I regretted this propensity, which was born in me, and will doubtless continue until dust returns to dust. My paternal grandfather was Captain Ephraim Barnum, of Bethel, a captain in the militia in the Revolutionary War. His son Philo was my father. He too was of a lively turn of mind and relished a joke better than the average of mankind. These historical facts I state as some palliation for my own inclination that way. What is bread in the bone, etc. I am not aware that my advent created any peculiar commotion in the village, though my good mother declares that I made a great deal of noise the first hour I saw the light, and that she has never been able to discover any cessation since. I must pass by the first 7 years of my life, during which my grandfather crammed me with sugar and loaded me with pennies to buy raisins and candies, which he always instructed me to solicit from the storekeeper at the lowest cash price, and proceed to talk of later events. I commenced going to school at the age of about 6 years. The first date which I recollect inscribing upon my writing book was 1818. I was generally accounted a pretty apt scholar, and as I increased in years, there were but two or three in school who were considered my superiors. In arithmetic, I was unusually quick, and I recollect, at the age of 12 years, being called out of bed one night by my teacher, who had laid a small wager with a neighbor that I could figure up and give the correct number of feet in a load of wood in 5 minutes. The neighbor stated the dimensions, and as I had no slate in the house, I marked them on the stovepipe, and thereon also figured my calculations, and gave the result in less than 2 minutes, to the great delight of my teacher, my mother, and myself, and to the no small astonishment of our incredulous neighbor. My father was a tailor, a farmer, and sometimes a tavern keeper, so I was often kept out of school, and never had any advantages except at the common district school, and one summer at the Academy in Danbury, a distance of 3 miles, which I marched and countermarched 6 times per week. Like most farmers' boys, I was obliged to drive and fetch the cows, carry in firewood, shell, corn, weed, beets, and cabbages, and as I grew larger, I rode horse for plowing, turned and raked hay, and in due time handled the shovel and the hoe, as well as the plow. But I never really liked to work. My organ of acquisitiveness must have been large, or else my parents commenced its cultivation at an early period. Before I was 5 years of age, I began to accumulate pennies and sixpennies. At the age of 6 years, my grandfather informed me that all my little pieces of coin amounted to $1, and if I would go with him and take my money, he would show me something worth having. Placing all my wealth in a pocket handkerchief, which was closely wound up and firmly grasped, I started with my grandfather. He took me to the village tavern, then kept by Mr. Stiles Wakely, and approaching the landlord, he said, "Here, Mr. Wakely, is the richest boy in this part of the country. He has $1 in cash. I wish you to take his change and give him a silver dollar for it." The complaisant landlord took my deposits and presently handed me a silver dollar. Never have I seen the time, nor shall I ever again, when I felt so rich, so absolutely independent of all the world, as I did when I looked at that monstrous big silver dollar and felt that it was all my own. Talk of cartwheels, there was never one half so large as that dollar looked to me. I believed, without the slightest reservation, that this entire earth and all its contents could be purchased by that wonderful piece of bullion, and that it would be a bad bargain at that. But my dollar did not long remain alone. My mother taught me that I should still save my pennies, and I did so. As I grew larger, my grandfather paid me 10 cents per day for riding the horse which preceded the ox team in plowing, and I hit upon various expedients for adding to my pile. On training days, instead of spending money, I was earning it in the vocation of a peddler. My stock in trade consisted of a gallon of molasses, boiled down and worked into molasses candy, called in those times cookania, and I usually found myself a dollar richer at the end of training than I was at the commencement. As I always had a remarkable taste for speculation, my holiday stock soon increased and comprised gingerbread cookies, sugar candies, and cherry rum. The latter article consisted of a demijohn of New England rum, in which was put a quantity of wild cherries, and I believe a little sugar. I soon learned that the soldiers were good cherry rum customers, and no sooner did I hear the words, "Halt, ground arms," than I approached the trainers with my decanter and wine glass. In a few years, I should have been a second Croesus in wealth had not my father considerately allowed me to purchase my own clothing. This arrangement kept my pile reduced to a moderate size. Always looking out for the main chance, however, I had sheep of my own, a calf of which I was the sole proprietor, and other individual property which made me feel, at 12 years of age, that I was a man of substance. I felt at the same time that I had not reached my proper sphere. The farm was no place for me. I always disliked work. Head work I was excessively fond of. I was always ready to concoct fun or lay plans for money-making, but handwork was decidedly not in my line. My father insisted that I could hoe and plow and dig in the garden as well as anybody else, but I generally contrived to shirk the work altogether, or by slighting it, get through with the day's work. I was not quite 12 years of age when I visited the commercial metropolis for the first time. It happened as follows. My father, as before stated, kept the village tavern. Late one afternoon in January 1822, Mr. Daniel Brown of Southbury, Connecticut, arrived at our house with a drove of fat cattle which he was taking to New York for sale. The stock were put into our large barnyard, the horses ridden by myself and assistant were stabled, and Mr. Brown, having partaken of a warm supper, drew off his boots, put on his slippers, and sat down by the fire to spend the evening comfortably. I looked upon him as a great man, for he had been to York, and to go to York in those days was thought quite as much as to go to Europe is now. I listened to the relation of his adventures in the city and country, my interest in the man continually increasing. At last I heard him say to my father that he expected to buy many more cattle in Ridgefield, and at other points on his way to the city, and he would be glad to hire a boy who was light of foot to run along with him and assist in driving the cattle. I immediately besought my father, like a modern office seeker, to intercede for me and, if possible, procure me the coveted situation. He did so. Consultation with my mother resulted in her consent, and it was immediately arranged that I should visit New York. I was told to retire at once, so as to be ready to start with a drove of cattle at daylight in the morning. I went to bed, but not to sleep. Visions of all sorts haunted my imagination. A new world was about to be opened to me. I slept an hour or two towards morning, dreaming of the great city with streets paved with gold and many castles in the air. At daylight I was aroused, took a few mouthfuls of breakfast, and started off on foot in the midst of a heavy snowstorm to help drive the cattle. Before reaching Ridgefield, Mr. Brown put me on his horse to gallop after a wandering ox. The horse fell, rolled upon my foot, and sprained my ankle. I suffered intensely, but dared not complain, lest my employer should contrive some way to send me back, for I was not yet 10 miles from home. He very considerately allowed me to ride behind him on the horse, and that night the landlady of the hotel where we stopped bathed my ankle, which was considerably swollen. The next day it was a trifle better, but as I continued to limp, Mr. Brown permitted me to ride most of the time. In 3 or 4 days we reached the city of New York and put up at the Bull's Head Tavern, kept, I think, by Mr. Givens. The drover would be busy a week selling his cattle, and then I was to return home with him in a sleigh. That was a great week for me. My mother gave me $1 before I left home, and I never expected to see the end of it. I supposed it would supply my every wish, and yet leave unknown quantities of small change on hand. The first outlay I made was for oranges. I was very fond of this fruit, and had often wished I could have as many as I could eat. I entered a confectionery store and inquired the price of oranges. 4 pence apiece was the reply. Now, 4 pence in Connecticut is 6 cents, and I supposed it was the same the world over. Profiting by my experience in beating down the price, and not doubting Franklin's proverb that a penny saved is 2 pence earned, I informed the lady that I considered 4 pence apiece too dear, but I would give her 10 cents for 2. The feminine shopkeeper hesitated for a moment, but finally said that seeing it was me, and as it was probably my first visit to New York, she would let me have the 2 oranges for 10 cents, but she should expect me to trade with her whenever I wanted anything in her line. I thanked her and took the oranges. I thought it was very liberal in her to make such a generous deduction from the price of her fruit, little dreaming that, owing to the difference in currency, I had paid her 2 cents more than she asked. Soon dispatching my 2 oranges, I purchased 2 more and had 80 cents left. This seemed to me sufficient for all mortal wants. I then bought for 31 cents a little gun, which would go off and send a stick some distance across the room. I intended to astonish my schoolmates with the gun when I got home, for it astonished me considerably, as I had never seen anything of the kind before. I went into the bar room of our hotel and began to amuse myself with the extraordinary implement. The bar room was crowded with customers, and, shooting at random, the arrow grazed one man's nose and passed on, hitting the barkeeper in the eye. Smarting under the pain it occasioned, the latter came in front of his counter, caught me by the collar, shook me sternly, boxed my ears till my head rung, and told me to put that gun out of the way or he would throw it into the stove. I felt considerably injured in my feelings, and sneaking slyly upstairs placed the precious treasure under my pillow. Visiting the toy shop again, the good woman instructed me in the mystery of torpedoes. She threw one with considerable force on the floor, and it exploded, greatly to my delight. Would not these astonish our schoolboys? I bought 6 cents worth for that purpose, but could not wait to use them at home. As the guests at the hotel were passing into dinner, and supposing that they had never seen anything in the torpedo line and would be delighted to do so, I could not refrain from giving them the opportunity. So, taking 2 from my pocket and throwing them with all my strength against the side of the hall through which the crowd was passing, a loud double report followed, much to the surprise and annoyance of the guests. The landlord came rushing out in a high state of excitement, and discovering the culprit, he stretched me upon the floor at a single blow with his open hand. "There, you little greenhorn!" he exclaimed. "See if that will teach you better than to explode your infernal crackers in my house again." It did. I was perfectly taught in a single lesson. went upstairs and deposited the balance of the torpedoes with my gun. I ate no dinner that day. My dignity had been insulted, and my appetite had vanished. I was humbled. I felt forlorn and forsaken. I, however, had one resource. It was the toy shop. I visited it again, bought a watch, a breastpin, and a top. I was still a rich man. I had 11 cents left. I went to bed and dreamed of all my possessions. The next morning, immediately after breakfast, I visited the toy shop again to look around and perceived many things which I had not noticed the day previously. Presently, I saw a beautiful knife with two blades, besides a gimlet and corkscrew. This was a novelty. The most useful article in existence, beyond all doubt. I must possess it. My father would be delighted, for it was a carpenter shop in miniature, and was too valuable an article to leave behind me. Wouldn't old Bethel be astonished? But what was the price of this combination of all that was useful and ornamental? Only 31 cents. Alas, I had only 11. I learned to my astonishment that my funds were exhausted. But have the knife I must, and so I proposed to my kind friend, the shopwoman, that she should receive back the top and breastpin at a slight deduction from what I had paid for them, and then, taking my 11 cents, should let me have the knife. The kind creature consented, and thus I made my first swap. Presently I discovered some molasses candy. It was whiter and nicer than any I had ever seen before. I must have some. So I asked the lady to take back the watch at a slight discount and give me the worth of it in molasses candy. She did so. It was delicious. I had never tasted anything so nice. And before night I had resigned my gun into her possession and swallowed its value in molasses candy. The next morning I swallowed all my torpedoes in the same shape, and in the course of the day even my knife followed in the sweet footsteps of its illustrious predecessors. Molasses candy was the rock on which I split. My money was all gone, my notions all swapped for it, and yet, like Oliver Twist, I cried for more. The good woman had a son about my size. I had no particular use for my two pocket handkerchiefs. The boy could use them, and I gladly accepted her proposal to trade them for 4 sticks of molasses candy. I had an extra pair of stockings, which I was sure I should never need, and they went for 5 more rolls of molasses candy. When thus divested of all I possessed, I became resigned to my fate, and turning my attention to some other source of excitement, I made the acquaintance of a young gentleman from Connecticut. He was about 20 years of age, had been in New York once before, knew the ropes, and proposed to show me the city. I gladly accompanied him, and saw many sights that day which astonished me beyond measure. My week was soon up. Mr. Brown took me into his one-horse sleigh immediately after dinner, drove as far as Sawpits, now called Port Chester, stopped overnight, started early the next morning, and arrived at Bethel the same evening. I had 1,000 questions to answer, and found my brothers and sisters much disappointed that I had brought them none of the fruits of my dollar. My mother examined my wardrobe, and finding it 2 pocket handkerchiefs and 1 pair of stockings short, I was whipped and sent to bed. Thus terminated my first visit to New York. I was, however, for a long time quite a lion among the schoolboys, for I had been to York, and seen with my own eyes many wonders which they had only heard tell of. Chapter 2. Clerk in a Store, Ivy Island. My aversion to hard work, on the farm or otherwise, continued to be manifested in various ways, all of which was generally set down to the score of laziness. I believe, indeed, I had the reputation of being the laziest boy in town, probably because I was always busy at headwork to evade the sentence of gaining bread by the sweat of the brow. In sheer despair of making anything better of me, my father concluded to try me as a merchant. He had previously erected a suitable building in Bethel, and taking Mr. Hiram Weed as a partner, they purchased a stock of dry goods, groceries, hardware, and 1,000 other notions, and I was duly installed as clerk in a country store. Like many greenhorns before me, this was the height of my ambition. I felt that it was a great condescension on my part to enter into conversation with common boys who had to work for a living. I strutted behind the counter with a pen back of my ear, was wonderfully polite to ladies, assumed a wise look when entering charges upon the day book, was astonishingly active in waiting upon customers, whether in weighing tenpenny nails, starch, indigo, or saleratus, or drawing New England rum or West India molasses. Ours was a cash, credit, and barter store, and I drove many a sharp trade with old women who paid for their purchases in butter, eggs, beeswax, feathers, and rags, and with men who exchanged for our commodities hats, axe helves, oats, corn, buckwheat, hickory nuts, and other commodities. It was something of a drawback upon my dignity when I was compelled to sweep the store, take down the window shutters, and make the fire. Nevertheless, the thought of being a merchant fully compensated me for all such menial duties. My propensities for money-making continued active as ever, and I asked and obtained the privilege of purchasing candies on my own account to sell to the juvenile portion of our customers. I received a small salary for my services. My father, as usual, stipulated that I should clothe myself, and I intended to be faithful to my employers. But I have found all through life that wherever there are conflicting interests, men are very apt to think of self first. And so I fear it was with me, for I well remember spending much time in urging indulgent mothers to buy candies for their darling children when other customers were waiting to be served with more substantial articles of merchandise. A country store in the evening, or upon a wet day, is a miserably dull place, so far as trade is concerned. Upon such occasions, therefore, I had little to do, and I will explain why the time did not hang unpleasantly upon my hands. In nearly every New England village, at the time of which I write, there could be found from 6 to 20 social, jolly, storytelling, joke-playing wags and wits, regular originals, who would get together at the tavern or store and spend their evenings and stormy afternoons in relating anecdotes, describing their various adventures, playing off practical jokes upon each other, and engaging in every project out of which a little fun could be extracted by village wits whose ideas were usually sharpened at brief intervals by a treat, otherwise known as a glass of Santa Cruz rum, Old Holland gin, or Jamaica spirits. Bethel was not an exception to this state of things. In fact, no place of its size could boast more original geniuses in the way of joking and storytelling than my native village. Luckily or unluckily, our store was the resort of all these wits, and many is the day and evening that I have hung with delight upon their stories, and many the night that I have kept the store open until 11 o'clock in order to listen to the last anecdotes of the two jokers who had remained long after their companions had gone to rest. There is something to be learned even in a country store. We are apt to believe that sharp trades, especially dishonest tricks and unprincipled deceptions, are confined entirely to the city, and that the unsophisticated men and women of the country do everything on the square. I believe this to be measurably true, but know that there are many exceptions to this rule. Many is the time I cut open bundles of rags, brought to the store by country women in exchange for goods, and declared to be all linen and cotton, that contained quantities of worthless woolen trash in the interior, and sometimes stones, gravel, ashes, etc. And sometimes, too, have I, contrary to our usual practice, measured the load of oats, corn, or rye, which our farmer customer assured us contained a specified number of bushels, perhaps 60, and found it 4 or 5 bushels short. Of course, the astonished woman would impute the rag swindle to a servant or neighbor who had made it up without her knowledge, and the man would charge carelessness upon his help, who measured the grain and, by mistake, made a wrong count. These were exceptions to the general rule of honesty, but they occurred with sufficient frequency to make us watchful of our customers and to teach me the truth of the adage, "There's cheating in all trades but ours." Like most persons in the New England states, I was brought up to attend church regularly on the Sabbath. Indeed, before I was able to read, I was one of the first scholars in Sunday school. We had but one church or meeting house in Bethel, Presbyterian, and here all attended. A difference in creeds and sects was scarcely known in our little country village at that time. The old meeting house had neither steeple nor bell, but in summertime it was a comfortable place for the inhabitants to congregate. My good mother would teach me my lessons in the New Testament and the Catechism, and my highest aspiration was to get every word so perfectly as to obtain the reward of merit. This valuable pecuniary consideration consisted of a ticket which stated that the bearer was entitled to 1 mill reward, so that 10 tickets were worth 1 cent. And as this reward was not payable in cash, but in Sunday school books at 10 cents each, it follows that 100 tickets would be required to purchase 1 book, so that a scholar must be successful every consecutive Sabbath, which was simply impossible, for the space of 2 years before he could come in possession of a tangible prize. Infinitesimal as was this recompense, it was sufficient to spur me to intense diligence. During the Reverend Mr. Lowe's ministrations at Bethel, he formed a Bible class, of which I was a member. We used to draw promiscuously from a hat a text of Scripture and write a composition on the text, which compositions were read after service in the afternoon to such of the congregation as remained to hear the exercises of the class. Once, I remember, I drew the text, Luke chapter 10, verse 42, "But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away her." Question, what is the one thing needful? My answer was nearly as follows. This question, what is the one thing needful, is capable of receiving various answers, depending much upon the persons to whom it is addressed. The merchant might answer that the one thing needful is plenty of customers, who buy liberally without beating down and pay cash for all their purchases. The farmer might reply that the one thing needful is large harvests and high prices. The physician might answer that it is plenty of patience. The lawyer might be of opinion that it is an unruly community always engaged in bickerings and litigations. The clergyman might reply, "It is a fat salary with multitudes of sinners seeking salvation and paying large pew rents." The bachelor might exclaim, "It is a pretty wife who loves her husband and knows how to sew on buttons." The maiden might answer, "It is a good husband who will love, cherish, and protect me while life shall last." But the most proper answer, and doubtless that which applied to the case of Mary, would be, "The one thing needful is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, follow in his footsteps, love God and obey his commandments, love our fellow man, and embrace every opportunity of administering to his necessities." In short, The one thing needful is to live a life that we can always look back upon with satisfaction, and be enabled ever to contemplate its termination with trust in Him who has so kindly vouchsafed it to us, surrounding us with innumerable blessings, if we have but the heart and wisdom to receive them in a proper manner. The reading of a portion of this answer occasioned some amusement in the congregation, in which the clergyman himself joined, and the name of Taylor Barnum was whispered in connection with the composition. But at the close of the reading, I had the satisfaction of hearing Mr. Lowe say that it was a well-written and truthful answer to the question, "What is the one thing needful?" Previous to my visit to New York, I think it was in 1820, when I was 10 years of age, I made my first expedition to my landed property, Ivy Island. This, it will be remembered, was the gift of my grandfather, from whom I derived my name. From the time when I was 4 years old, I was continually hearing of this property. My grandfather always spoke of me, in my presence, to the neighbors and to strangers as the richest child in town, since I owned the whole of Ivy Island, one of the most valuable farms in the state. My father and mother frequently reminded me of my wealth and hoped I would do something for the family when I attained my majority. The neighbors professed to fear that I might refuse to play with their children because I had inherited so large a property. These constant allusions for several years to Ivy Island excited at once my pride and my curiosity and stimulated me to implore my father's permission to visit my property. At last he promised I should do so in a few days, as we should be getting some hay near Ivy Island. The wished-for day at length arrived, and my father told me that as we were to mow an adjoining meadow, I might visit my property in company with the hired man during the nooning. My grandfather reminded me that it was to his bounty I was indebted for this wealth, and that had not my name been Phineas, I might never have been proprietor of Ivy Island. To this my mother added, "Now, Taylor, don't become so excited when you see your property as to let your joy make you sick, for remember, rich as you are, that it will be 11 years before you can come into possession of your fortune." She added much more good advice, to all of which I promised to be calm and reasonable, and not to allow my pride to prevent me from speaking to my brothers and sisters when I returned home. When we arrived at the meadow, which was in that part of the plum trees known as East Swamp, I asked my father where Ivy Island was. "Yonder, at the north end of this meadow, where you see those beautiful trees rising in the distance." All the forenoon I turned grass as fast as two men could cut it, and after a hasty repast at noon, one of our hired men, a good-natured Irishman named Edmund, took an axe on his shoulder and announced that he was ready to accompany me to Ivy Island. We started, and as we approached the north end of the meadow, we found the ground swampy and wet, and were soon obliged to leap from bog to bog on our route. A misstep brought me up to my middle in water. To add to the dilemma, a swarm of hornets attacked me. Attaining the altitude of another bog, I was cheered by the assurance that there was only a quarter of a mile of this kind of travel to the edge of my property. I waded on. In about 15 minutes more, after floundering through the morass, I found myself half-drowned, hornet-stung, mud-covered, and out of breath, on comparatively dry land.
"Never mind, my boy," said Edmund. "We have only to cross this little creek, and you'll be upon your own valuable property."
We were on the margin of a stream, the banks of which were thickly covered with alders. I now discovered the use of Edmund's axe, for he felled a small oak to form a temporary bridge to my island property. Crossing over, I proceeded to the center of my domain. I saw nothing but a few stunted ivies and straggling trees. The truth flashed upon me. I'd been the laughingstock of the family and neighborhood for years. My valuable Ivy Island was an almost inaccessible, worthless bit of barren land, and while I stood deploring my sudden downfall, a huge black snake, one of my tenants, approached me with upraised head. I gave one shriek and rushed for the bridge. This was my first, and I need not say, my last visit to Ivy Island. My father asked me how I liked my property, and I responded that I would sell it pretty cheap. My grandfather congratulated me upon my visit to my property as seriously as if it had been indeed a valuable domain. My mother hoped its richness had fully equaled my anticipations. The neighbors desired to know if I was not now glad I was named Phineas, and for 5 years forward I was frequently reminded of my wealth in Ivy Island. In the month of August, 1825, my maternal grandmother met with an accident which, although considered trivial at the time, resulted in her death. While walking in the garden, she stepped upon the point of a rusty nail, which ran perhaps half an inch into her foot. It was immediately extracted, but the foot became swollen, and in a few days the most alarming symptoms were manifest. She was soon sensible that she was upon her deathbed, but she was a good Christian, and her approaching end had no terrors for her. The day before her departure, and while in full possession of her faculties, she sent for all her grandchildren to take their final leave of her. I never can forget the sensations which I experienced when my turn came to approach her bedside, and when, taking my hand in hers, she spoke to me of her approaching dissolution, of the joys of religion, the consoling reflections that a deathbed afforded those who could feel that they had tried to live good lives and be of benefit to their fellow men. She besought me to think seriously of religion, to read my Bible often, to pray to our Father in heaven, to be regular in my attendance at church, to use no profane or idle language, and especially to remember that I could in no way so effectually prove my love to God as in loving all my fellow beings. I was affected to tears and promised to remember her counsel. When I received from her a farewell kiss, knowing that I should never behold her again alive, I was completely overcome, and however much I may have since departed from her injunctions, the impressions received at that deathbed scene have ever been vivid among my recollections, and I trust they have proved in some degree salutary. A more sincere Christian or a more exemplary woman than my grandmother I have never seen. Chapter 3. More Experiences as a Country Clerk. Among the various ways which I had for making money on my own account from the age of 12 to 15 years was that of lotteries. One of our neighbors, a pillar in the church, permitted his son to indulge in that line, the prizes consisting of cakes, oranges, molasses candy, etc., and the morality of the things being thus established, I became a lottery manager and proprietor. The highest prize was generally $5, sometimes less, and sometimes as high as $10. All the prizes in the lottery amounted to from $12 to $25. The cost of the entire tickets was 20 or 25% more than the prizes. I found no difficulty in disposing of my tickets to the workmen in the hat and comb manufactories, etc. Lotteries in those days were patronized by both church and state. As a writer has said, people would gamble in lotteries for the benefit of a church in which to preach against gambling. My father was brought to his bed with a severe attack of fever in March, and departed this life, I trust for a better world, on the 7th of September, 1825, aged 48 years. I was then 15 years of age.
I stood by his bedside. The world looked dark indeed when I realized that I was forever deprived of my paternal protector. I felt that I was a poor, inexperienced boy, thrown out on the wide world to shift for myself, and a sense of forlornness completely overcame me. My mother was left with 5 children. I was the oldest, and the youngest was only 7 years of age. We followed the remains of husband and parent to their resting place and returned to our desolate home, feeling that we were forsaken by the world and that but little hope existed for us this side of the grave. Administrators to the estate were appointed, and the fact was soon apparent that my father had not succeeded in providing any of this world's goods for the support of his family. The estate was declared insolvent, and it did not pay 50 cents upon a dollar. My mother, like many widows before her, was driven to many straits to support her little family, but being industrious, economical, and persevering, she succeeded in a few years in redeeming the homestead and becoming its sole possessor. The few dollars which I had accumulated I had loaned to my father and held his note, therefore, that it was decided that the property of a minor belonged to the father and my claim was ruled out. I was subsequently compelled to earn as clerk in a store the money to pay for the pair of shoes that were purchased for me to wear at my father's funeral. I can truly say, therefore, that I began the world with nothing, and was barefooted at that. I remained with Mr. Weed as clerk but a little longer, and then removed to Grassy Plain, a mile northwest of the village of Bethel, where I engaged with James S. Keeler and Lewis Whitlock as clerk in their store at $6 per month, and my board, my mother doing my washing. I soon entered into speculations on my own account, and by dint of economy succeeded in getting a little sum of money ahead. I boarded with Mrs. Jerusha Wheeler and her daughters, Jerusha and Mary. As nearly everybody had a nickname, the two former ladies were called Rusia, the old lady being designated Aunt Rusia. They were an exceedingly nice and worthy family and made me an excellent home. I chose my uncle, Allenson Taylor, as my guardian and was guided by his counsel. I was extremely active as a clerk, was considered a cute trader, and soon gained the confidence and esteem of my employers. I remember with gratitude that they allowed me many facilities for earning money. On one occasion, a peddler called at our store with a large wagon filled with common green glass bottles of various sizes, holding from half a pint to a gallon. My employers were both absent, and I bantered him to trade his whole load of bottles in exchange for goods. Thinking me a greenhorn, he accepted my proposition, and I managed to pay him off in unsaleable goods at exorbitant prices. Soon after he departed, Mr. Keeler returned and found his little store half filled with bottles. "What under heavens have you been doing?" he said in surprise. "I have been trading goods for bottles," said I. "You have made a fool of yourself," he exclaimed, "for you have bottles enough to supply the whole town for 20 years. I begged him not to be alarmed and promised to get rid of the entire lot within 3 months. "If you can do that," said he, "you can perform a miracle." I then showed him the list of goods which I had exchanged for the bottles, with the extra prices annexed, and he found upon figuring that I had bartered a lot of worthless trash at a rate which brought the new merchandise to considerably less than one half the wholesale price. He was pleased with the result, but wondered what could be done with the bottles. We stowed away the largest portion of them in the loft of our store. My employers kept what was called a barter store. Many of the hat manufacturers traded there and paid us in hats, giving store orders to their numerous employees, including journeymen, apprentices, female hat trimmers, etc., etc.
Of course, we had a large number of customers, and I knew them all intimately. I may say that when I made the bottle trade, I had a project in my head for selling them all, as well as getting rid of a large quantity of tinware which had been in the store for some years and had become begrimed with dirt and fly specks. That project was a lottery. On the first wet day, therefore, when there were but few customers, I spent several hours in making up my scheme. The highest prize was $25, payable in any kind of goods the customer desired. Then I had 50 prizes of $5 each, designating in my scheme what goods each prize should consist of. For example, one $5 prize consisted of one pair cotton hose, one cotton handkerchief, two tin cups, four pint glass bottles, three tin skimmers, one quart glass bottle, six tin nutmeg graters, 11 half-pint glass bottles, etc., etc., the glass and tinware always forming the greater portion of each prize. I had 100 prizes of $1 each, 100 prizes of 50 cents each, and 300 prizes of 25 cents each. There were 1,000 tickets at 50 cents. The prizes amounted to the same as the tickets, $500. I had taken an idea from the church lottery, in which my grandfather was manager, and had many prizes of only half the cost of the tickets. I headed the scheme with glaring capitals, written in my best hand, setting forth that it was a magnificent lottery, $25 for only 50 cents, over 550 prizes, only 1,000 tickets, goods put in at the lowest cash prices, etc., etc. The tickets went like wildfire. Customers did not stop to consider the nature of the prizes. Journeyman hatters, boss hatters, apprentice boys, and hat-trimming girls bought tickets. In 10 days they were all sold. A day was fixed for the drawing of the lottery, and it came off punctually as announced. The next day, and for several days thereafter, adventurers came for their prizes. A young lady who had drawn $5 would find herself entitled to a piece of tape, a spool of cotton, a paper of pins, 16 tin skimmers, cups, and nutmeg graters, and a few dozen glass bottles of various sizes. She would beg me to retain the glass and tinware and pay her in some other goods, but was informed that such a proceeding would be contrary to the rules of the establishment and could not be entertained for a moment. One man would find all his prizes to consist of tinware. Another would discover that out of 20 tickets, he had drawn perhaps 10 prizes, and that they consisted entirely of glass bottles. Some of the customers were vexed, but most of them laughed at the joke. The basket loads, the arms full, and the bags full of soiled tin and glass bottles which were carried out of our store during the first few days after the lottery drawing constituted a series of most ludicrous scenes. Scarcely a customer was permitted to depart without one or more specimens of tin or green glass. Within 10 days, every glass bottle had disappeared, and the old tinware was replaced by a smaller quantity as bright as silver. My grandfather enjoyed my lottery speculation very much, and seemed to agree with many others who declared that I was indeed a chip of the old block. On Saturday nights, I usually went to Bethel to remain with my mother and attend church on the Sabbath. My mother continued for some years to keep the village tavern. One Saturday evening, a violent thundershower came up. It was very dark and rained in torrents with occasional intervals of a few minutes. Miss Mary Wheeler, who was a milliner, sent word across to the store that there was a girl at her house from Bethel who had come up on horseback to obtain her new bonnet, that she was afraid to return home alone, and if I was going to Bethel on horseback that night, she wished me to escort her customer. I assented, and in a few minutes my horse was at Aunt Ruchia's door. I went in and was introduced to a fair, rosy-cheeked, buxom-looking girl with beautiful white teeth named Cherry Hallett. Of course, Cherry was a nickname, which I subsequently learned meant charity. I assisted the young lady into her saddle, who was soon mounted on my own horse, and we trotted slowly towards Bethel. The brief view that I had of this girl by candlelight had sent all sorts of agreeable sensations through my bosom. I was in a state of feeling quite new to me, and as unaccountable as it was novel. I opened a conversation with her, and finding her affable and in no degree prim or stuck up, although she was on horseback, I regretted that the distance to Bethel was not 5 miles instead of one. A vivid flash of lightning at that moment lighted up the horizon and gave me a fair view of the face of my interesting companion. I then wished the distance was 20 miles at least. I was not long in learning that she was a tailoress, working with Mr. Zerah Benedict of Bethel. The tailoring trade stood much higher in my estimation from that moment than it ever did before. We soon arrived at Bethel, and bidding my fair companion good night, I went to my mother's. The girl's face haunted me in my dreams that night. I saw her the next day at church, and on every subsequent Sunday for some time, but no opportunity offered that season for me to renew the acquaintance. Messrs. Keeler and Whitlock sold out their store of goods to Mr. Lewis Taylor in the summer of 1827. I remained a short time as clerk to Mr. Taylor. They have a proverb in Connecticut that the best school in which to have a boy learn human nature is to permit him to be a tin peddler for a few years. I think his chances for getting his eye teeth cut would be equally great in a country barter store like that in which I was clerk. As before stated, many of our customers were hatters, and we took hats in payment for goods. The large manufacturers generally dealt pretty fairly by us, but some of the smaller fry occasionally shaved us prodigiously. There probably is no trade in which there can be more cheating than in hats. If a hat was damaged in coloring or otherwise, perhaps by a cut of half a foot in length, it was sure to be patched up, smoothed over, and slipped in with others to send to the store. Among the furs used for the nap of hats in those days were beaver, russia, nutria, otter, coney, muskrat, etc., etc. The best fur was otter, the poorest was coney. The hatters mixed their inferior furs with a little of their best and sold us the hats for otter. We in return mixed our sugars, teas, and liquors, and gave them the most valuable names. It was dog-eat-dog, tit-for-tat. Our cottons were sold for wool, our wool and cotton for silk and linen. In fact, nearly everything was different from what it was represented. The customers cheated us in their fabrics. We cheated the customers with our goods. Each party expected to be cheated, if it was possible. Our eyes, and not our ears, had to be our masters. We must believe little that we saw, and less that we heard. Our calicoes were all fast colors, according to our representations, and the colors would generally run fast enough and show them a tub of soapsuds. Our ground coffee was as good as burned peas, beans, and corn could make, and our ginger was tolerable, considering the price of cornmeal. The tricks of trade were numerous. If a peddler wanted to trade with us for a box of beaver hats worth $60 per dozen, he was sure to obtain a box of conies, which were dear, at $15 per dozen. If we took our pay in clocks, warranted to keep good time, the chances were that they were no better than a chest of drawers for that purpose, that they were like Pindar's razors, made to sell, and if half the number of wheels necessary to form a clock could be found within the case, It was as lucky as extraordinary. As drunk as a hatter has long since passed into a proverb. There were some sober hatters in the times of which I write, but there were also many drinking ones. The hatters from out of town bought their rum by the keg or barrel, while those on grassy plains kept a man whose almost sole duty it was to go to and from the store and shops with half a dozen rum bottles of various sizes. Some of these bottles were replenished several times in a day. My business, of course, included the filling of rum bottles. I suppose I have drawn and bottled more rum than would be necessary to float a ship. Such a school would cut eye teeth, but if it did not cut conscience, morals, and integrity all up by the roots, it would be because the scholars quit before their education was completed. Chapter 4. In Business for Myself. In the autumn of 1826, Mr. Oliver Taylor, who had removed from Danbury to Brooklyn, Long Island a few years previously, offered me the position of clerk in his grocery store. He had also a large comb factory in Brooklyn and a comb store in New York. I accepted Mr. Taylor's offer. The store was at the corner of Sands and Pearl Streets. Many of our customers were early ones to buy articles for their breakfasts, and I was obliged to rise before daylight. This was so different from my previous habits that I had much difficulty in waking in the morning. To aid me in my endeavors at diligence, I arranged with a watchman, at 2 shillings per week, to pull a string which hung out of my chamber window in the third story, one end being fastened to my big toe. The arrangement fully answered the purpose, but Mr. Taylor became acquainted with it, through the watchman, I believe, and on one occasion there was a more violent pulling than I had bargained for. I howled with pain, ran to the window, and bade the watchman desist, else he would pull my toe off. Not suspecting a trick, I dressed myself, went downstairs, and discovered that it was only 12:30. It was a long time before I ascertained who my tormentor was, though I might reasonably have suspected Oliver. But after that adventure, I managed to wake without assistance and discharge the watchman in toto. I had not been long in Mr. Taylor's employment before I became conversant with the routine of the business, and the purchasing of all the goods for the store was soon entrusted to me. I bought for cash entirely, and thus was enabled to exercise my judgment in making purchases, sometimes going into all sections of the lower part of the city in search of the cheapest markets for groceries. I also frequently attended the wholesale auctions of teas, sugars, molasses, etc., so that by watching the sales, noting the prices, and recording the names of buyers, I knew what profits they were realizing and how far I could probably beat them down for cash. At these auctions, I occasionally made the acquaintance of several grocers who wanted small lots of the goods offered for sale, and we frequently clubbed together and bid off a lot, which, being divided between us, gave each about the quantity he desired and at a reduced price from what we should have been compelled to pay if the goods had passed into other hands and thus been taxed with another profit. My employer manifested great interest in me and treated me with the utmost kindness, but the situation did not suit me. The fact is, there are some persons so constituted that they can never be satisfied to labor for a fixed salary, let it be never so great. I am one of that sort. My disposition is, and ever was, of a speculative character, and I am never content to engage in any business unless it is of such a nature that my profits may be greatly enhanced by an increase of energy, perseverance, attention to business, tact, etc. As, therefore, I had no opportunity to speculate on my own account in this Brooklyn store, I soon became uneasy. Young as I was, and probably because I was so young, I began to think seriously of going into business for myself, and although I had no capital to start on, several men of means had offered to furnish the money and join me in business. I was just then at an uneasy age, in a transition state, neither boy nor man, an age when it is of the highest importance that a youth should have some discreet friend and instructor on whose good counsel he can rely. In the summer of 1827, I caught the smallpox, which, although I had been vaccinated successfully some 8 years previously, assumed a very severe type of varioloid. This confined me to the house for several months. The expense attending my sickness made a sad inroad upon my funds. As soon as I was sufficiently recovered, I started for home to spend a few weeks in recruiting my health, taking passage on board a sloop for Norwalk. When the passengers, numbering 20 ladies and gentlemen, came on board, they were frightened at the appearance of my face, which still bore strong marks of the disease from which I had just recovered. By a unanimous vote, I was requested to go on shore, and Captain Munson Hoyt, whom I well knew, having been in the habit of visiting his sloop weekly for the purchase of butter, eggs, etc., informed me that he was pained in conveying to me the wishes of the affrighted passengers. Of course, I felt compelled to comply, and left the sloop with a heavy heart. I lodged that night at Holt's old hotel in Fulton Street, and the next morning went to Norwalk by steamboat, reaching Bethel the same afternoon. I spent several weeks with my mother, who was unremitting in her exertions to make me comfortable. During my convalescence, I visited my old schoolmates and neighbors generally, and had several opportunities of slightly renewing the short acquaintance which I had formed with the attractive tailoress, Cherry Hallett, while escorting her on horseback from grassy plains to Bethel in the thunder shower. These opportunities did not lessen the regard which I felt for the young lady, nor did they serve to render my sleep any sounder. However, I did not tell my love, and the worm in the bud did not feed on my pockmarked cheek. At the end of 4 weeks, I again left the maternal roof and departed for Brooklyn. In a short time, I made arrangements for opening a porterhouse on my own hook in the neighborhood of the grocery store, and, giving Mr. Taylor the requisite notice of my desire to leave his employment, he engaged a practiced hand as my successor, and I opened the porterhouse. Within a few months, I found an opportunity of selling out to advantage, and as I had a good offer to engage as clerk in a similar establishment kept by Mr. David Thorpe, 29 Peck Slip, New York, I sold out and removed thither. Mr. Thorpe's place was a great resort of the Danbury and Bethel comb-makers, hatters, etc., and this giving me a constant opportunity of seeing my townsmen, made it very agreeable. I boarded in Mr. Thorpe's family, who used me very kindly. He allowed me frequent opportunities of visiting the theater with such of my companions as came to New York. I had much taste for the drama, soon became, in my own opinion, a close critic, and did not fail to exhibit my powers in this respect to all the juveniles from Connecticut who accompanied me to the theater. My habits generally were not bad. Although constantly engaged in selling liquor to others, I probably never drank a pint of liquor, wine, or cordials before I was 22 years of age. I always attended church regularly, and was never without a Bible in my trunk, which I took frequent occasion to read. In February 1828, my grandfather wrote to me that if I would come to Bethel and establish some kind of business for myself, he would allow me to occupy, rent-free, one half of his carriage house. I had a strong desire to return to my native village, and after several weeks' reflection, I accepted his offer. The carriage house referred to was situated on the public street in Bethel, and I concluded to finish off one part of it and open a retail fruit and confectionery store. Before leaving New York, I consulted several fruit dealers with whom I was acquainted and made arrangements for sending them my orders. I then went to Bethel, arranged the building, put in a small stock of goods, including a barrel of ale, and opened my establishment on the first Monday morning in May 1828, that being our military training day. The hopes and fears which agitated me for weeks previously to this, my first grand opening, have probably never had a parallel in all my subsequent adventures. I was worth about $120, and I invested all I possessed in this enterprise. It cost me $50 to fit up my little store, and $70 more purchased my stock in trade. I am suspicious that I received little good from attending church the day previously to opening my store, for I distinctly remember being greatly exercised in mind for fear it would rain the next day and thus diminish the number of customers for my cakes, candies, nuts, raisins, etc. I was up betimes on Monday morning and was delighted to find the weather propitious. The country people began to flock into the village at an early hour, and the novelty of my little shop, which was set out in as good style as I was capable of, attracted their attention. I soon had plenty to do, and before noon was obliged to call in one of my old schoolmates to assist me in waiting upon my numerous customers. Business continued brisk during the whole day and evening, and when I closed I had the satisfaction of counting out $63 as my day's receipts. My entire barrel of ale was sold, but the assortment of other goods was not broken up, nor apparently very seriously diminished, so that although I had received the entire cost of my goods, less $7, the stock on hand showed that my profits had been excellent. I need not attempt to relate how gratified I was by the result of my first day's experiment. I considered my little store as a fixed fact, and such it proved to be. I put in another barrel of ale, and proceeding to New York, expended all of my money for a small stock of fancy goods, and such articles as I thought would find a ready sale. My assortment included pocketbooks, combs, beads, cheap finger rings, pocket knives, and a few toys. My business continued good during the summer, and in the fall I added stewed oysters to my assortment. My grandfather had great pleasure in my success and advised me to take the agency of some lottery dealer for the sale of lottery tickets on commission. Lotteries were at that time legal in Connecticut and were generally considered as legitimate a branch of business as any other. I therefore adopted my grandfather's advice and obtained an agency for selling lottery tickets on a commission of 10%. This business, connected with the fruit, confectionery, oyster, and toy establishment, rendered my profits quite satisfactory. On one occasion, a young man of my acquaintance called to examine some pocketbooks. He inquired the prices and finally selected one that pleased him. He said he would take it, but he desired me to give him a credit on it for a few weeks. I told him that had he wanted any article of necessity which I had for sale, I would not object to trusting him a short time. But it struck me that a pocketbook was something of a superfluity for a person who had no money. He replied that it did not strike him in that light, and that he did not see why it was not as proper to seek credit for a pocketbook as for anything else. He, however, failed to convince me of the necessity of his possessing such an article until he had something to put into it, and I therefore declined his proposition. About this time, I made arrangements to go to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, with Mr. Samuel Sherwood of Bridgeport on an exploring expedition. I had heard that there was a fine opening in that city for a lottery office, and Sherwood and myself concluded to try our fortunes there, provided we found the prospects equal to our anticipations. We called at the office of the New York managers, Yates and McIntyre, and had an interview with their chief businessman, Mr. Dudley S. Gregory, subsequently mayor and a large proprietor in Jersey City. Mr. Gregory did not think favorably of Pittsburgh, but after an hour's conversation with me, he offered me the entire lottery agency for the state of Tennessee, if I would go to Nashville and open an office there. The proposition was tempting, but I feared the distance was too great to meet the approbation of a certain tailoress in Bethel, whose wishes I felt bound to consult for special reasons. I therefore declined giving an answer for 2 weeks. In the meantime, Sherwood and myself, having given up the Pittsburgh trip, concluded to go to Philadelphia for a pleasure excursion. We went in a morning boat to New Brunswick, where the passengers all took stages to Bordentown, a distance of perhaps 30 miles through the sand, where we again took steamboat to Philadelphia, arriving there about dusk. We put up at Congress Hall in Chestnut Street, where we experienced rather taller living than we had ever before met with. The array of waiters, napkins, and other etceteras, as well as a frequent change of plates, was something entirely ahead of all our former experience. But we lay off like old stagers and lived in clover for a week, going to the theater every night and riding in our coach every day. On Sunday, we listened to the chiming bells of Christ Church with great satisfaction, it being the first we had ever heard. At last, we concluded to start for home. Our hotel bill astonished us beyond measure, and awakened serious apprehensions in regard to our ability to raise sufficient funds to reach home. Counting up both our piles, we found that our fears were not without foundation. We had been foolishly extravagant in our outlays, and after paying our hotel bills and securing our tickets for New York, we had only 27 cents left. This was decidedly a close shave. Fortunately, we discovered our dilemma before breakfast, and as that meal had been included in our bill, each of us embraced the opportunity, while sipping our coffee, to pocket a few biscuits, which sufficed us for a dinner we could not buy. As we were about leaving the hotel, the bootblack asked us to remember him, to which Sherwood replied that it was an imposition. He had always, while traveling, been accustomed to having his bootblacking included in the bill, and he would not stand it. I tried to look indignant also, but was overcome, and, putting my hand in my pocket, drew forth a quarter dollar and handed to the polisher of our understandings. This reduced our capital to 2 cents, and with this we started, saying to the porter that, merely for the sake of the exercise, we preferred to carry our own trunks. Living all day upon our biscuits and cold water, we reached New York and carried our baggage to Holt's Hotel in Fulton Street, a distance of about a mile. In the morning, Sherwood borrowed a couple of dollars from a Bridgeport friend, and, proceeding to Newark, obtained the loan of $50 from his friend and cousin, Dr. Sherwood. He loaned me one half the amount, and after sojourning a few days in New York, we returned home. I do not know what Sherwood's feelings were, but I was forcibly reminded, as I have often been since, of the old adage that a fool and his money are soon parted. Our visit to the New York lottery managers greatly enlightened me in regard to the profits of that line of business. I had been in the habit of selling tickets for Washington Yale, the editor and printer in Danbury, also for O.W. Sherwood and his cousin Samuel of Bridgeport, for a commission of 10% to 15%. But in my interviews with Mr. Gregory, I learned that the managers, taking to themselves the 15% deducted on all prizes, furnished tickets to their agents at what was called scheme price, which allowed the agents from 25% to 30% profit. The lotteries being drawn by combination numbers, the public generally had no knowledge whatever of the number of tickets in a lottery. The managers, therefore, made the prizes amount to less than the retail price of tickets by 25% or 30%. This extra percentage was a shave additional to the 15% allowed in old-fashioned lotteries. I also learned that the process of arriving at the number of tickets in a lottery is this. Multiply the three highest combination numbers and divide by 6. The quotient is the number of tickets. After learning the profitable basis of the foregoing facts, I went to our Connecticut lottery managers and from that time obtained my tickets directly from them at the scheme price. In my turn, I established agents all through the country, and my profits were immense. I sold from $500 to $2,000 worth of tickets per day. At this time, my Uncle Allenson Taylor joined me as a partner in the lottery business and proved a very efficient salesman. On one occasion, I sold a package of quarter tickets to my Aunt Laura Nichols and a neighbor of hers for $25. Before the lottery was drawn, the neighbor sickened of her bargain and begged me to take the tickets back, and my aunt consented. When the mail brought the drawn numbers from Hartford, I had the package of tickets on hand. Not desiring to risk that amount of money, I induced 8 of my customers to join me in the purchase of the package. We then opened the letter containing the drawn numbers and found that we had drawn a quarter of the highest prize, $15,000. This result gave myself and 8 others a profit of $350 each. The fact was duly announced, and my aunt never ceased to blame her timid neighbor, nor to lament her own ill fortune. The great luck of drawing the highest prize spread like wildfire, as usual in such cases, and the country for miles around was lottery crazy. Our sales increased immensely. Fully appreciating the powers of the press, to which more than to any other one cause I am indebted for my success in life, I did not fail to invoke the aid of Printers, Inc. I issued handbills, circulars, etc. by tens of thousands, with striking prefixes, affixes, staring capitals, marks of wonder, pictures, etc. The newspapers throughout the region teemed with unique advertisements. Immense gold signs and placards in inks and papers of all colors covered my lottery office. As the curious letters of Joe Strickland were highly popular at the time, I advertised my office as being under the special favor and protection of Dr. Peter Strickland, own blood cousin to the renowned Joe Strickland, etc. In my bills and advertisements, I rung all possible changes upon the renowned name. The ever-lucky Dr. Strickland. 5 more capital prizes sold by Dr. Strickland. A fortune for a dollar. Apply to fortune's favorite, Dr. Strickland. Another mammoth prize. Huzzah for Dr. Strickland. Etc., etc. Homemade poetry was also frequently brought into requisition to set forth the inducements for patronizing my office. Customers who brought their tickets and found them blanks were told that their only wise plan was to look for their money where they lost it. It was a long lane that never turned. Such bad luck could not continue long, etc., etc. The lucky drawers of the high prize before mentioned gave an oyster supper at my mother's tavern to about 60 persons, whom I invited, knowing them to be good ticket customers. And after the supper was finished, I counted out the prize money to the elated holders of the fortunate ticket. This so excited our guests that a package of tickets, amounting to $1,000, was forthwith sealed up and bought by 50 subscribers on the spot, at $20 each. Selling so many tickets as I did, a prize of $1,000 or $2,000, and numerous smaller ones, must occasionally turn up. These, being duly trumpeted, rendered mine the lucky office in the estimation of many. I received orders from distant parts of the country by mail, and sent out tickets on commission by post riders and others. Among my private customers were a number of clergymen and deacons, and occasionally some of the weak brothers of the Shakers, who came to Bethel to sell garden seeds, bought a few lottery tickets on the sly. Whenever I visited Brookfield, I called on one man who was of serious turn. He and his wife were professors of religion, and he was a frequent exhorter at prayer meetings. He always managed to buy a ticket or two from me, under the strictest injunction never to divulge the fact to his wife. I usually dined with him, and when he was busy looking after my horse or otherwise engaged out of doors, I never failed to sell a ticket to his wife, who begged me to be very careful not to let her husband have any suspicion of it, for he was opposed to such things and would never forgive her if he should know there was a lottery ticket in the house. I still kept a close eye upon the attractive tailoress, Charity Hallett, and although my good mother and some other relatives feared that I was not looking high enough in the world, those who knew the girl best declared that she was an industrious, excellent, sensible, and well-behaved girl, and some of them added that she was altogether too good for Taylor Barnum. I perfectly agreed with them in their conclusions, and in the summer of 1829 I proved it by asking her hand in marriage. My suit was accepted and the wedding day appointed. In the meantime, I applied myself closely to business, no person suspecting that the event was near at hand. In October, my sweetheart went to New York, ostensibly to visit her uncle, Nathan Beers, who resided at No. 3 Orchard Street. I left home on Saturday, November 7th, for New York, having particular occasion to purchase goods for our little store. On the next evening, by the aid of Reverend Dr. Macaulay, and in the presence of sundry relatives and friends of hers, the tailoress changed her name to Mrs. Charity Barnum, and I became the husband of one of the best women that was ever created. I was at that time little more than 19 years of age. I have long felt assured that had I waited 20 years longer, I could not have found another woman so well suited to my disposition and so valuable as a wife, a mother, and a friend. Yet I do not approve of nor recommend too early marriages. The bride and bridegroom returned to Bethel the same week and took board in the family where she had previously resided. My mother received me as if nothing had happened and made no allusion to the wedding. She evidently felt chagrined at the clandestine manner of my marriage, but I called on her every day with the same freedom that I had ever done, and within a month she invited me to bring my wife and spend the following Sabbath with her. I did so, and from that day to this, I am sure that neither she nor any other person ever said or believed that I had not been extremely fortunate in the selection of my companion. In the winter of 1829-30, I opened a lottery office in the village of Danbury, still keeping up the Bethel office, as well as branches in Norwalk, Stamford, Middletown, etc., and a host of small agencies all through the country for 30 miles around. In June 1830, I purchased from my grandfather 3 acres of land in Bethel, a few rods south of the village, for the purpose of erecting a dwelling thereon. Lewis Osborne, the builder, put me up a 2.5-story house, 26 by 30 feet, for $1,050, and my wife and myself moved into it and commenced housekeeping the ensuing spring. My ticket sales were now confined in a great measure to a few large customers who bought liberally and to whom I gave a credit. Leaving these large customers in the hands of a trusty clerk, I went into a book speculation for a couple of months. I purchased books at auction and otherwise in New York, and taking them around the country, advertised and sold them at auction, I acting as auctioneer. I did tolerably well, with 2 exceptions. I held my auction one night at Litchfield, Connecticut. The law school was located there at that time. The students were among my customers, and they managed to steal a large number of the most costly books. The same thing was done in Newburgh, New York, and I quit the auction business in disgust. In the same spring of 1831, I put up a building in Bethel known as the Yellow Store, making it sufficiently capacious to accommodate a family in the second and third stories. In July 1831, my uncle Allenson and myself opened the establishment with an assortment of goods, such as are usually found in a country store, consisting of dry goods, groceries, hardware, crockery, etc., etc. Like most persons who engage in a business which they do not understand, we were unsuccessful in the enterprise, and on the 17th of October, I bought out my uncle's interest, as will be seen by the following advertisement, which I cut from a newspaper dated the 20th of that month. Dissolution. The firm of Taylor and Barnum is this day dissolved by mutual consent. Allenson Taylor, Phineas T. Barnum. The business will be conducted in future by P. T. Barnum, who will sell all kinds of dry goods, groceries, crockery, etc., etc., 25% cheaper than any of his neighbors. Bethel, October 17th, 1831. Chapter 5. Brief Editorial Career. Removal to New York. About this time, circumstances partly religious and partly political in their character led me into still another field of enterprise which honorably opened to me that notoriety of which in later life I surely have had a surfeit. Considering my youth, this new enterprise reflected credit upon my ability as well as energy, and so I may be excused if I now recur to it with something like pride. In a period of strong political excitement, I wrote several communications for the Danbury Weekly paper, setting forth what I conceived to be the dangers of a sectarian interference which was then apparent in political affairs. The publication of these communications was refused, and I accordingly purchased a press and types, and on October 19, 1831, I issued the first number of my own paper, The Herald of Freedom. I entered upon the editorship of this journal with all the vigor and vehemence of youth. The boldness with which the paper was conducted soon excited widespread attention and commanded a circulation which extended beyond the immediate locality into nearly every state in the Union. But lacking the experience which induces caution, and without the dread of consequences, I frequently laid myself open to the charge of libel, and three times in 3 years I was prosecuted. A Danbury butcher, a zealous politician, brought a civil suit against me for accusing him of being a spy in a Democratic caucus. On the first trial, the jury did not agree, but after a second trial, I was fined several hundred dollars. Another libel suit against me was withdrawn and need not be mentioned further. The third was sufficiently important to warrant the following detail. A criminal prosecution was brought against me for stating in my paper that a man in Bethel, prominent in the church, had been guilty of taking usury of an orphan boy and for severely commenting on the fact in my editorial columns. When the case came to trial, the truth of my statement was substantially proved by several witnesses and even by the prosecuting party. But the greater the truth, the greater the libel, and then I had used the term usury instead of extortion, or note-shaving, or some other expression which might have softened the verdict. The result was that I was sentenced to pay a fine of $100 and to be imprisoned in the common jail for 60 days. The most comfortable provision was made for me in Danbury Jail. My room was papered and carpeted. I lived well. I was overwhelmed with the constant visits of my friends. I edited my paper as usual and received large accessions to my subscription list. And at the end of my 60 days term, the event was celebrated by a large concourse of people from the surrounding country. The courtroom in which I was convicted was the scene of the celebration. An ode, written for the occasion, was sung. An eloquent oration on the freedom of the press was delivered, and several hundred gentlemen afterwards partook of a sumptuous dinner, followed by appropriate toasts and speeches. Then came the triumphant part of the ceremonial, which was reported in my paper of December 12, 1832, as follows. P.T. Barnum and the band of music took their seats in a coach drawn by 6 horses, which had been prepared for the occasion. The coach was preceded by 40 horsemen and a marshal bearing the national standard. Immediately in the rear of the coach was the carriage of the orator and the president of the day, followed by the committee of arrangements and 60 carriages of citizens, which joined in escorting the editor to his home in Bethel. When the procession commenced its march amidst the roar of cannon, 3 cheers were given by several hundred citizens who did not join in the procession. The band of music continued to play a variety of national airs until their arrival in Bethel, a distance of 3 miles, when they struck up the beautiful and appropriate tune of Home Sweet Home. After giving 3 hearty cheers, the procession returned to Danbury. The utmost harmony and unanimity of feeling prevailed throughout the day, and we are happy to add that no accident occurred to mar the festivities of the occasion. My editorial career was one of continual contest. I, however, published the 160th number of the Herald of Freedom in Danbury, November 5, 1834, after which my brother-in-law, John W. Amerman, issued the paper for me at Norwalk till the following year, when the Herald was sold to Mr. George Taylor. Meanwhile, I had taken Horace Fairchild into partnership in my mercantile business in 1831, and I had sold out to him and to a Mr. Tussaud in 1833, they forming a partnership under the firm of Fairchild and Company. So far as I was concerned, my store was not a success. Ordinary trade was too slow for me. I bought largely, and in order to sell, I was compelled to give extensive credits. Hence, I had an accumulation of bad debts, and my old ledger presents a long series of accounts balanced by death, by running away, by failing, and by others similarly remunerative returns. I had expended money as freely as I had gained it, for I had already learned that I could make money rapidly and in large sums when I set about it with a will, and hence I did not realize the worth of what I seemed to gain so readily. I looked forward to a future of saving when I should see the need of accumulation. In the winter of 1834-35, I removed my family to New York, having hired a house in Hudson Street. Strictly speaking, I entered that great city to seek my fortune. Lotteries in the state of Connecticut had been prohibited by law. I had lost large amounts of money by my private customers, some of whom had gone beyond their means in purchasing tickets, while others had put their property out of their hands and thus defrauded me of considerable sums. When I moved to New York, I had no pecuniary resources except such as were derived from old debts left in the hands of an agent in Bethel for collection. I had hoped to find an opening with some mercantile firm in New York, where for my services I could receive a portion of the profits, for I had a disposition which ever revolted at laboring for a fixed salary. I wanted an opportunity where my faculties and energies could have full play, and where the amount of profits should depend entirely upon the amount of tact, perseverance, and energy which I contributed to the business. But I could not find the situation I coveted. My resources began to fail me, and, my family being in ill health, I found it difficult to maintain them. In order to do so, I secured the situation of drummer to several stores, including the cap and stock store of Mr. Chapman in Chatham Street, the proprietors of which allowed me a small commission on all sales which they made to customers whom I introduced. This, of course, was only a temporary arrangement, and, like Micawber, I was continually on the lookout for something better to turn up. Every morning at sunrise, my eyes were running over the columns of wants in the New York Sun, hoping to hit upon something that would suit me. Many is the wild goose chase which I had in pursuit of a situation so beautifully and temptingly set forth among those wants. Fortunes equaling that of Croesus, and as plenty as blackberries, were dangling from many an advertisement which mysteriously invited the reader to apply at room number 16 in the fifth story of a house in some retired and uninviting locality. But when I had wended my way up flights of dark, rickety, greasy stairs and through somber, narrow passages, I would find that my fortune depended firstly upon my advancing a certain sum of money, from $3 to $500, as the case may be, and secondly upon my success in peddling a newly discovered patent life pill, an ingenious mousetrap, or something of that sort. I remember that on one occasion an advertisement...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.